Hi, it's Kiffin Levates here, and today I thought I would talk about identity and access management in simple terms and look at centralized, federated, and decentralized identity and access management. Now, normally people talking about IAM, or identity and access management, in the blockchain space use terms like self-sovereign identity and stuff, but I think it's actually helpful to look at what it is that you can do when you have proved that you are who you are in the three different systems that I talked about. And when I first looked at centralized and federated identity and access management, I was surprised at how simple it actually really is. What a centralized system wants to be able to do is have some kind of persistence of identity for you. So you sign up with an account the first time you log on, that's called registering, and from that point onwards you then log on, and only you can log on, or that's the idea anyway, and then you get access to the services that you have paid for example, on the server. And what the server does is it presents you with a challenge that only you are supposed to be able to respond to, and typically this is with a password and a user identity or a UID, and in some cases you may add in two-factor authentication or some other means to really make sure that you are who you are. Now, in a federated authentication system, the server kind of farms out the responsibility for maintaining your identity over time to some other entity, for example, to Facebook or LinkedIn or Google, with one of those login using one of these open authentication providers. But it's basically the same thing that's going on under the hood, namely that only you are able to authenticate yourself to LinkedIn or to Facebook or whoever, and they then pass on that information to the server that you're trying to log into. And so really, your identity on a server is nothing more than being able to prove that the person trying to access a service today is the same as the person who was trying to do it yesterday and the week before and so on and so forth. Now, in decentralized identity and access management, the big difference is that rather than a database on the server or on one of the third-party authentication service providers holding the information about you, that information is stored on a blockchain. And the significance of that is that the blockchain is not under the control of any one of these centralized authorities. And as a result, your identity can't be taken off you. And similarly, if you have bought services that are, for example, represented by an NFT held in the address that you're using for authentication, then provided it's not a malicious NFT contract, that NFT can't be taken off you either. Now, that doesn't stop the third-party service from ignoring the fact that you have the NFT, and I'll get back to that in a moment, because let's go back to the authentication and the access management side of things now. So, in a decentralized system, you would create an identity for yourself simply by spinning up a new Ethereum address. And all you have to do that is generate a truly random 256-bit number. And there are plenty of systems out there that allow you to do that with varying levels of security. For example, if you have a hardware wallet, then the whole password, or rather the private key holding stuff, is looked after for you in a secure way. If you're using something like MetaMask, well, it's in your browser, it's probably less secure. And if you've gone to some JavaScript website to create your identity for you, then you're probably doomed. But anyway, you've created this 256-bit random number, so that's quite a big number, and that is then used to derive a public address, and that address becomes your identity on the blockchain and in the decentralized systems as a whole. And now when you go to one of these servers, the challenge that the server gives you is to prove that you are in control of that private key. And as long as you've been careful with that private key, that becomes kind of like your identity. They'll send you a challenge and you sign it with the private key, and then the server can check that it was correctly signed, and only you should be able to do that. And now they know that it is indeed you revisiting the site with a particular Ethereum address. So that's all very well and good. And the neat thing about this is, because the blockchain is not under the control of the other entities, you've created your own identity, it's stored on the blockchain, and you're in control. That's where the kind of self-sovereign idea comes from. And then what servers can do is they could offer various different services. Maybe some of them need to be paid for, maybe some of them you get as a reward for being a loyal customer. And one of the mechanisms they could use to manage the access management is to mint NFTs representing those services and then transfer them to your address. So now the rights that you have on the server, the access management part, is managed through the NFTs. And that means you log on with your Ethereum address. That Ethereum address has NFTs representing the fact that you have a premium account, representing the fact that you've been using the site for a year, or maybe that you've made over 1,000 edits to the wiki that it's running or something like that. And that gives you privileges. And the server just checks, oh yes, this address has this array of NFTs. That means that that user is allowed to do all these things. And with another user, it might go, well, they have no NFTs with this address. They're basically just a guest at this stage. And this is exactly what I've done with Richard Piacentini in the Orthoverse. You have an Ethereum address that you can use to log on to orthoverse.land. And you don't have to. You can just come in as a guest, or you can come in with an Ethereum address that does not own an Orthoverse token. And then you can wander around and look at things. But if you happen to own a land token and you go to that land in the Orthoverse metaverse, then suddenly you'll find that you are allowed to actually edit what is in that space, in this 96 by 96 voxel area. Oh, and it's 256 blocks high. And the way that my server manages that is it's checked that you are who you say you are because you've signed an initial challenge. And then it's checked that you own a land token. And when it detects that you are in that land, then it gives you a whole load of functionality. A hotbar appears that allows you to mine blocks and place blocks and so on and so forth. And it really is just as simple as that. But of course, the big difference is that there's not a LinkedIn or a Facebook or somebody out there who is managing your identity. You're doing that yourself. And I, as the Orthoverse server runner, cannot take that identity off you, and I can't take the NFT off you. However, here's the caveat, and that is that although you may still own the token, I control the server that creates the world, and so I could implement something that says, I'm going to ignore this particular NFT. I have taken a dislike to the person who owns the land one south of the Southern Henge, and I'm going to have a special bit of line of code that says, even though they have this NFT, they're not allowed to edit their land. And this is one of the things that I think people miss about decentralized identity and or access management, which is that ultimately, if there's a service that's being provided, the service provider can still arbitrarily decide to censor some people and say, you're not allowed to have this service. So it's not completely free and open and nothing can be taken off you. However, at least you'll still have that token and you may have the opportunity to sell it on to somebody who hasn't been ban listed from the particular service that the service provider has decided to censor you for. So it's not all perfect, but it's kind of getting there. And as we see more developments in the realm of decentralized websites, which is something that I really should talk about at some point, we should see some of that extra censorship risk also disappearing. Anyway, this went on a bit longer than I wanted it to, but believe me, from a technical point of view, this stuff is not rocket science. It's all actually available out there. Using an Ethereum address as a way to log on to places is perfectly feasible because we're doing it in the Orthoverse right now. And strangely enough, it really is literally just 10 lines of code or something like that. We're not talking about masses and masses of complicated stuff that needs to be done in order to enable it. I think I could get a prototype for pretty much any website up and running in a matter of a day or two. Then, of course, there's all the security testing that needs to be done, but we're pretty much there. And I think also from a security perspective, this has the potential to be a lot better than the Web2 identity management systems that we are currently using, which have become a bit of a sort of Frankenstein monster in that pieces have been bolted onto them to try and overcome the problems that have cropped up over time. Multi-factor authentication being one of them, and lots of mistakes have been made in there. So in the Web3 world, there's a lot there that we can learn from. Anyway, that's today's video on identity and access management in a decentralized world. I hope you found it interesting, and I'll see you in the next video soon. Bye for now.